Welcome back to Dave Newell's channel. This is Jamaica Politics 1980s. Dance, dancehall, and drugs. Please subscribe.
Jacob Miller.
The main architects were Bucky Marshall from PNP-affiliated Matthews Lane and Claudius Messup from the JLP stronghold of Tivoli Gardens. Here is Messup's widow, Sidonie, with more on Claudius and the peace treaty.
Both parties and their leaders have created this tension between the vulnerable and the ignorant. And that's why I think he got the peace movement going. Because he was saying, these guys are sitting on their verandas every evening after work, drinking their scotch, right? And we're down here suffering, can't find $2 to rub together to go to the market to buy some cabbage.
There's a feeling, a feeling of security. Out in the streets and out.
Messup had been a childhood friend of Bob Marley. So after hatching the peace plan in late 1977, Messup, Marshall, and other garrison leaders appealed to Marley to return to Jamaica. Self-imposed exile in England to help support the troops.
He said, you know, listen, I'm going to call Bob. Bob needs to be back and be part of all of this. All of us, we need to really cut this crap and bring Bob home and try and live in peace with one another.
In February 1978, Marley returns.
The welcome home was, you know, just fantastic. You know, some people would have said it was on par when Selassie came to Jamaica, you know, the way he was welcomed back home.
In April 1978, the One Love Peace Concert was held, featuring 16 of Jamaica's top music acts. In the middle of his performance, Bob Marley invited Michael Manley and Edward Siaga to join him on stage, linking their hands together above his head in a gesture of solidarity.
Could we have up here on stage here the presence of Mr. Michael Manley and Mr. Edward Siaga? Oh! And show the people that we're gonna meet and rise. We're gonna unite. We're gonna meet and rise. We gotta unite.
But the peace treaty proved short-lived. In February 1979, Claudius Messup was killed by police. His body reportedly marked by 129 bullet entries. Others connected to the peace treaty also met violent death. Wars were mounting. Unemployment leapt to new highs. Foreign exchange reserves vanished, causing major inflation. Manley withdrew from the IMF in early 1980, and a split within the PNP significantly worsened. Here is Smith again.
That the left in Jamaica was actually very divided on the issue of whether or not they would support what Michael Manley was doing. There were people who felt that Michael Manley was not going far enough. So this notion that somehow there was a unified left-wing movement that was being somehow hobbled by a violent right-wing counteraction with JLP and Siaga needs to be tempered with a greater sensitivity to the Jamaican political scene in the late 1970s.
The election resulted in a landslide victory for Siaga and the JLP.
It was one of the biggest losses ever experienced in Jamaican politics for Michael Manley. And it was read as a complete and final defeat of democratic socialism and of any left-wing chances in Jamaican politics. The left had been disappointed with him with the IMF deal, and the middle-class sector in Jamaica that had conventionally been supportive of the People's National Party, going back to the days of Norman Manley, felt betrayed by Michael Manley and what he had been doing. In fact, there was a anecdote that was very alive at the time, that if you put a dog to run against Michael Manley in 1980, the dog would win.
With Siaga, a new era of Jamaican politics began.
In terms of after 1980, Siaga comes to power in Jamaica the same year Ronald Reagan comes to power in the United States. And it is often treated as a beginning of a right-wing shift in politics in the Americas generally. And so Siaga is portrayed quite commonly as being very pro-US, pro-Reagan, during the period of his prime ministership in the 1980s.
Siaga got inflation under control, stimulated production, and strengthened ties with the U.S. In 1983, Siaga called the snap election. It was boycotted by Manley in protest at the GLP's refusal to update the electoral roll. The boycott cemented the GLP's hold on the country for the rest of the decade. But there was another major shift taking place in Jamaica that would have drastic consequences. Cocaine.
You see an expansion in the 1980s, which is a pan-Caribbean problem then, it's a pan-Caribbean problem now. The drug trade becomes a fillip for a developing or a new development within the violence and the criminal industry in Jamaica, which had in the decade before, and violent crime had been so polarized along ideological and party lines and also turf lines, now has this added element of the drug trade.
Jamaica became a way station for the international cocaine trade, and gang members from both sides of the political split were involved.
And so the crime and violence in Jamaica in the 1980s, rather than becoming this bright day that some people thought would happen with Siaga and the removal of Manley, actually becomes far more complicated, far more diffuse, and beyond the control of any political party or leader.
As cocaine became more prevalent, Jamaican music also changed. New technology brought the digital dancehall era. And with the free market mentality taking hold, many lyricists turned away from social issues, focusing instead on tales of sex, drugs, and guns. But some songs still addressed social and political topics. The success of Junior Reid's 1989 hit, One Blood, suggested that Jamaicans were rejecting the old tribalism.
You could have come from Rima, or you come from jungle. Could have come from firehouse, or you come from Tower Hill. One blood, one blood, one blood.
The 1989 election was relatively peaceful, a sign that the influence of politics was waning in the garrison communities. And when Michael Manley returns to office in 1989 once more, the rhetoric of democratic socialism is absent.
It was a very different Michael Manley, and I think Manley too was very responsive to the wider global climate at the time, where there was more of a movement towards the right.
Political differences between parties were also less apparent.
So you still have a sense of party division and a sense of allegiance to the parties for, you know, different reasons, historical reasons, but not as strongly pronounced as before.
Battling prostate cancer, Manley stood down in 1992, and his deputy, P.J. Patterson, took office. Manley succumbed to cancer in 1997. The end of the line for one of Jamaica's most iconic political figures. Here is Max Romeo again.
When Marley dead, politics dead for me. The philosophy that he portrayed, these guys, is not with it. And I think it was good philosophies. You know, Jamaica is not for sale. Jamaica is for Jamaicans, and try to do otherwise. As PJ Patterson take over, I sell out half the bloody island, and it's a trend selling it out, because I think when Michael was talking, these guys was laughing.
Yeah. Hey. From jungle to Rima,
country passive,
from devolution not usually.
Apply with it.
Through the 90s and into the 2000s, many Garrison gangs turned into powerful drug cartels with an overseas reach. The Shower Posse of Tivoli Gardens, led by Christopher Goodes Coke, was one of the most notorious. Much like the earlier dons of Tivoli, Goodes was seen as a leader, providing Tivoli's residents with money, jobs, and more.
He was a, what we call in Jamaica, a don of the area. That means he was a local person who had a strong degree of power within that region. And as a result of that, that power was used to create the infrastructure that it was often felt that the state couldn't provide. But that sort of power was a power that is extremely given to abuse.
In August 2009, he tried to extradite Coke.
He was wanted in the United States for drug trafficking, which had become a serious issue from the 1980s on. And there was a request for his extradition.
When the request was made, the JLP was back in power, led by Prime Minister Bruce Golding. But due to the JLP's long-standing relationship with Tivoli Gardens, the request was denied.
What
after facing months of pressure, Golding finally honored the request in May 2010. But capturing Coke was no easy task.
Security forces and the administration believed, or rather knew, that that power was so strong that it would take security forces to uproot it, that it had become a sort of network of control that spanned beyond Tivoli Gardens.
This the politician, they know how to see. Yard in a spanglass in a unity. Say downtown shut down for 3 days.
The outcome was yet again another state of emergency in the country. And the military forces were sent into Tivoli Gardens specifically to take Christopher Coke.
76 died in the assault and hundreds were detained.
There is a clash between the security forces and the people of Tivoli Gardens that spoke to a wider problem that followed us into independence that's still not been resolved between security forces and their violence towards people in inner city Jamaica.
Golding's poor handling of the affair led to his resignation. Jamaican music continues to comment on political and social events, remaining a powerful alternative.
Please smash that ravishing like button.
But Manley's government had different plans.
Going into the 1976 election, Michael Manley and his administration were very keen to getting some support from Bob Marley. That show, though, of course, becomes absorbed by the state. Now, Bob Marley publicly never endorsed any party, either the PNP or the JLP, during this period in 1976. And so he tried really hard to navigate away from being in any position where he had to declare his hand.
2 weeks before the Smile Jamaica show, Manley called a snap election to be held just 10 days after the concert. Political tension surged again, and 2 days before the concert, Bob Marley was shot at his home on Hope Road.
So this is the assassination of Bob Marley's life. Turning point for Jamaica, but also turning point for Bob Marley, because, you know, he goes and performs 2 days later after the concert at the Smile Jamaica show, which takes place at Heroes Park, and, you know, becomes legendary for that performance in the process.
We don't need no trouble. What we need is love.
often he performs, he goes into exile, but coming back to Jamaica, of course, the elections are scheduled and they go through, and unsurprisingly, Michael Manley wins. Been any definitive idea or answer to the question who shot Bob Marley? The most recurring ones have been associated with the CIA. Was there CIA activity in Jamaica during the 70s? Of course, I think there's quite a lot of evidence that shows that. Did the CIA feel it necessary to support a move against Bob Marley is another issue altogether. There are many other reasons why somebody might want to take a shot at Bob Marley, especially when he was seen as endorsing, not by his design by any means, but he was seen as endorsing Michael Manley's candidacy.
Dave Natch, I'm out.